Good morning. Welcome. It's nice to see you all in God's house this morning. For those who've been away on holidays, welcome back. It's good to see a few extra people around the building and a few extras in the band. For those who are visiting our congregation today, welcome. I hope that you'll have the opportunity to stay for a tea or coffee and a biscuit afterwards and some good conversation. Let's share in a psalm together first. Psalm 15. Lord, who may dwell in your sanctuary? Who may live on your holy hill? He whose walk is blameless and who does what is righteous, who speaks the truth from his heart and has no slander on his tongue. Who does his neighbour no wrong and casts no slur on his fellow man? Who despises a vile man but honours those who fear the Lord? Who keeps his oath even in hurt times? Who lends his money without usury and does not accept the bribe against the innocent? He who does these things will never be shaken. May God truly bless us this morning as we gather together to share in fellowship, to share in prayer, to share in worship, and most importantly, to share God's word as a congregation this morning. Let's commence our meeting with Song 399, Song 399, the tune you will know, To God Be the Glory. However, we aren't singing the chorus because we're singing slightly different words. So I invite you to stand, restrain yourself from breaking into the chorus. It won't be happening, okay? And we have four verses, I think. Sorry, five. No, that's too many. Let's sing verses 1, 2, and 5, please. Be seated. I don't know about you, but I found that a little difficult not to break into the chorus between the verses. Some announcements this morning. We acknowledge that COVID is on the rise again. If you want to wear a mask during the meeting, please feel free to do so. I notice now in the shopping centres a few more people are starting to wear their masks. So it's your choice. If you want to put a mask on, please do so. Remember to keep your social distance if you can and continue washing your hands and looking after yourself. As I've said already, welcome back to those who've been away on holidays, but in particular, welcome back to David and Dorothy who have been unwell. It's good to see your smiling faces, and I just acknowledge that God is truly a God who answers prayer, and it's great to see you both here this morning. And to know that Agnes is recovering as well. There'll be no service next Sunday at the hall due to people being away for the Congress in Birmingham. There will be an online meeting if you wish just to log in online and watch. That meeting has been prepared already. Some I know are choosing to go to another service on Sunday. That's fine too, okay? Enjoy yourself. If you wish to go and worship and fellowship in another corps next Sunday, you're more than welcome to do so. Please continue to pray for those who are still on holidays, and we trust that they will come back refreshed and relaxed and ready for the rest of the year as we continue serving God as a congregation together. As we come to a time of prayer, song number 571, 571. As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. An opportunity just to reflect on our attitude as we hunger and thirst after God's teaching for us. Hunger and thirst as we study his word. To hunger and thirst as we seek fellowship with other believers and with our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who continues to encourage us and help us to grow each day. Let's sing the first verse and the chorus, please. Let's pray. Lord God, we are grateful for the opportunity to come and share in fellowship and worship here this morning. We thank you for the safe return of those who've been away on holidays, those who are recovering from illness. We acknowledge, Father God, that indeed you are a God who answers prayer and answers prayer abundantly. We would ask, Lord God, that as we share today, that you would encourage us and challenge us through your word. As Gail speaks to us this morning about Mary and Martha, may we be reminded, Lord, of the important things in the word that reminds us of how best we can serve you each and every day. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing verse 3 and the chorus together, please. Forgot one announcement, sorry. We've had word this morning that Anne Hawksworth is in Blackpool Victoria Hospital. She's had a fall and is recovering in hospital but waiting for updates. Today, tomorrow, we will try and contact officers closer to where she is to see if they can follow her up and let us know what's going on. Having surgery today. Okay, sorry, having surgery today, so... We pray that the surgery will go well. So we might just take this opportunity now just to do that. Lord God, we thank you because you are a God that answers prayer. We pray for Anne. We ask that you would give her a real sense of peace as she awaits the surgery this morning. And we just ask, Father God, that you will be with the doctors and nurses that are caring for her. May the operation go well and her recovery be full and swift. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. The band will now bring us their message this morning. Thank you to the band this morning. Take time to be holy. Wise words for us, I think, today. Our next song is Song 150, Song 150. Tell me the old, old story of things unseen above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I think this is a song that we need to stand up for. Let's stand, if you'd like, and we'll sing verses 1 and 2.
Thank you.
Do you believe in the old story? Yes. How many times do we tell it to other people? We don't have to say it. We can live it. We can share with our neighbours over the fence with kindness and support. That's also telling the old story of Jesus and his love. I pray that's something that we do every single day, not just to one another, but to people that do not know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Saviour. Let's sing verses 3 and 4, please. Please be seated. Our Bible reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10, verses 38 to 42. And the title of the reading is At the Home of Mary, of Martha and Mary. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, they came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to them. She had a sister called Mary, whom sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me. Martha, Martha, the Lord answered, you are worrying and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. May God grant us understanding of his word this morning.
Good morning. It's a big Bible. It's big print for us who can't read, see. I have a sister. And she's 3 years older than what I am. Even though we may look similar, we are very, very different. We have different personalities, we have different likes, we have different dislikes. We very much dress differently, we very much have different hair. We think very differently. I have a sister who loves to do craft work. She loves to do gardening. Craft work, and I know if it can't be finished in five minutes, you can forget it. Obviously, she has a lot more patience than what I have. But although we're officers, our officership also, because of our different personalities and skill sets, have taken us down very different paths. Yet there is nothing wrong with people, the people we are, because we have been made as individuals with different talents and abilities. And our scripture today is about two sisters who are also very, very different. And yet I often feel that they are treated as the good sister and the bad sister. Do you ever feel like that when you read Mary and Martha? And whenever anyone calls you a Martha, it's almost said in a negative term. Well, I believe this is incorrect. They are just very different personalities. And Martha sees herself as traditional and attends to household duties as was expected of her. It was a society where generosity and hospitality was culturally important and expected. Whereas Mary, she breaks that mould of what society expected of her, and she sits at the feet of Jesus in the place where a disciple would sit. And disciples were normally men, but there she is. She's sitting there at the feet of Jesus as a disciple, listening and learning. And now this caused frictions between the sisters. So although the dialogue is mainly about Martha in the scripture passage, if we look at John 11 and the death of Mary and Martha's brother Lazarus, we see the relationship that Martha had with Jesus. And in John 11:5, it says, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So Martha is identified by name as being loved by Jesus. Now further on, when Lazarus had died, it is Martha that goes out to meet Jesus, whereas Mary stayed in the house. It is Martha who expresses that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. They are the words she says to Jesus. She wasn't expecting Jesus to raise her brother from the dead, but she had faith that whatever Jesus asked of God would be done even now. Then we go to verse 27 of John 10, and we also see that Martha believed that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into this world. So we often think of Martha as being a practical person, which no doubt she was, but she was also a very strong woman of faith who recognised who Jesus was. Whereas her sister Mary, she was a much freer spirit and was more expressive and sensitive. And we see how expressive Mary is when we look at John 12, and she anoints Jesus. So the passage we are reading today is not saying that Martha did not have faith, but just at that time she had become distracted with the preparations for a meal and not what was seen to be more important. So we live in a world with so many distractions. And one of the biggest distractions of these days is mobile phones. And I don't see anyone with their mobile phone out today. I have learnt very early on when I'd see people with mobile phones think they're on their phone, but in reality a lot of people actually use them to look up the Bible readings, so I'm told. But anyway, according to statistics, between 2014 and 2019, a total of 133 fatalities and 446 serious accidents occurred in the UK using a mobile phone while driving. But it is not only driving. I have seen people walk out onto the road without looking because they are looking at their phones. Parents become so engrossed in their phones that they don't see what their children are doing or even have the time to spend with their children. Important things are put aside to spend hours looking at videos, following somebody online, texting, and looking at other various online things. Personally, I don't see the excitement of it, but for other people, they do. But we as Christians can also be distracted by the same things and many other things in life. So distractions can disconnect us from God. So to be distracted means that our attention is being diverted from the important things that we should be doing. And I have to confess, I did confess earlier on, I did get distracted yesterday with the sunshine. And it was beautiful, wasn't it? I hope you enjoyed summer. But I have a hammock, which we brought all the way from Australia to various places. And I thought, oh, I know I should be preparing for today and getting things ready, but I'd like to just lie out in that little hammock in the sunshine. So we set up the hammock and I laid out there in the sunshine for an hour. It was lovely. It wasn't what I was supposed to be doing, but boy, I enjoyed it. Up until the time I couldn't get out of it and I had to ask for assistance. And I'd say that before my husband told everybody.
I'll take a video.
But when we are distracted, our relationship with God suffers as we don't spend the time with him that we should. We don't spend time in prayer. And look at that, we have a moth distracting people. We don't spend time looking in his word. We've disconnected ourselves. And I can always remember a testimony of a person who was being re-enrolled as a soldier or a uniformed Salvationist. She had previously resigned as an officer when she had realised that she had become disconnected with God. And she said the only time that she ever read the Bible was when she was preparing a sermon. The only time she prayed to God was when it was in an official capacity. She had realised she had totally disconnected from God and she was just going through the motions of being an officer. Our relationship with God is not just a Sunday relationship, but it is a relationship that continues 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We can talk to God anytime, anywhere, whether you're doing the washing up, hanging clothes on the line, putting petrol in your car at the petrol station. You can chat with God anytime, anywhere. But if we are so distracted by less important things, then we cannot spend the time with God each day as is needed. A relationship, any form of relationship, does not form unless we take time out to spend time with that person. And when we don't take time out to spend with God, well, then we are placing him second, third, fourth place or even lower in our priorities. And when we step away from God and we disconnect from him, we become influenced by things that are not of God. And if we look at Martha, here she was, she had Jesus in her house, but she was so distracted by the busyness that she actually wasn't spending the time with her guest and with somebody that she loved and who loved her deeply. She wasn't giving him the attention that he deserved. She wasn't listening to his words and learning from his words. So our busyness can be a distraction, as you can see from this cartoon. So intent on writing the word help that you don't realise help has arrived. So here we have Martha is in the kitchen doing the preparations alone. So she's unable to hear What Jesus is saying to Martha, to Mary. And this her busyness of being in the kitchen and thinking Mary should be in there, it led to her becoming resentful to Mary and to, dare I say, angry with Jesus. And she accuses Mary of laziness and accuses Jesus of lacking concern for her. And I'm sure there's times that we have felt like that, when we feel like we're doing all the work and somebody else is not pulling their weight. And we do, we become quite annoyed or resentful for it. But Jesus responded with, Lord, don't you care that my sister... Oh no, Mary says, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me. So it's not just this conflict with her and Mary, but she's now dragged Jesus into it as well. But we can lose the joy of serving Jesus and the joy of being in a relationship with him when it all becomes about doing rather than being like Mary and sitting at the feet of Jesus and listening to him. And being distracted by our business, it just doesn't happen. Doesn't just happen outside of this church, but it can also happen inside this church. And over the years, I have watched people burn out, become discontented or bitter because they are working so hard at the church. They end up judging others because they are not doing as much work as what they are, and they become resentful. Yes, we need to serve in the church, but not out of obligation or for our own recognition or out of resentment, but because we love to serve God and we love to serve others. And I have to admit, many, many years ago, we were working 6 days a week in the church, but all we did was become angry and resentful. We weren't spending our time with God. It was about duty. And it is something that we need to be careful of, that what we do here is also for the right reasons. So if it is all about what we are doing, then we have lost sight of why we serve and we have disconnected with Jesus. So making right priorities. So in life, we all have to set priorities, whether it is with family, whether it's with our finances, whether it's with our relationships, whether it's with work. And our priorities will always depend on what is most important for that moment. Yet our relationship with Jesus always needs to be a priority. Luke 10, 41 to 42, Jesus says, Martha, Martha, you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. Or the voice says, Oh, Martha, Martha, you are so anxious and concerned about a million details, but really only one thing's matter. Mary has chosen that one thing, and I will not take it away from her. For that time, the priority was sitting and listening and being with Jesus, because he was not going to be on this earth for too much longer. Mary had chosen the important thing. Jesus was with them now, and the attention needed to be focused on him and his teaching. He was giving spiritual food, and food for the body could wait. So as Christians, we need to ask ourselves regularly, where are our priorities? Our relationship with God is a priority. So we need to be intentional in spending time with him. We need to ensure that we have fellowship with other believers. And when we are serving God and others, it needs to be done out of love and not out of a sense of duty that leads to resentment. There are even times that we need to say no. And I know for some people, they find it hard to say no. But if we are asked to do something in the church that will negatively impact us or our families, there is a time that we need to say no. God understands our situations and he knows when we need to take time out, and we need to take time out and meditate on him. So this morning I ask that we examine our lives and we see if we have disconnected from God through busyness or through distractions or because he's no longer a priority, the priority that he needs to be. We need to ask ourselves if we have become disconnected, what do we need to do to reconnect with God? We're going to sing a song, which is song 565 in the book. And the first two lines says, all I once held dear, built my life upon, all this world reveres and wars to own. All I once thought gain, I have counted lost, spent and worthless now compared to this. Knowing you, Jesus, there is no greater thing. And ask the question, is he your all? Is he the best? Is he your joy, your righteousness? And do you love him? Let's join together in singing the first two verses. Pray. Dear Lord, we pray that you will guard our hearts this day from all the things that fight for our attention. In our church and family, help us to fix our eyes on you and not our position in the church, or the sins of others, or the differing minute points of theology, or how or where we worship. May we come out of the kitchen and spend time sitting at the feet of Jesus. So, Lord, this morning we ask that you will reveal the things to us, the things that distract us, the things that we become too busy at, Lord. And I pray that you will give us a sense of love and joy in the service that we do here in our church and in our community, Lord. Make those things be very real to us. May you really speak into our hearts. And Lord, I just pray we'll also be very intentional in spending our time with you throughout the week. Amen and amen. Our final song this morning is song 74. And we're only going to, there's a lot of verses on this. This is verse 5, and I will not make you sing all verse 5. But we will sing verse 1, 2, and 5 straight through, and I invite you to stand. May the Lord of love be the passion in your heart. May the joy of God be your strength when times are hard. May the presence of God give you a peace that overflows. And may the word of God be the seed that you might sow to others. God bless you this week as you go out into your communities and to your families to love and serve the Lord. Amen.